Okay then, Phil. So we're going to have a little look at your stroke now from above and below the water from a range of different angles and just try and see if you can identify what's probably holding you back within your swimming and how we can actually make you become a little bit more efficient as we're swimming along. Yeah. Just before I show yourself, obviously you've explained the issue with the left side there. You're going to see actually much better range of movement than we see with a lot of swimmers here. So okay. You're actually doing really well to actually compensate for that within the stroke. But what do you think, if you had to put your finger on it, what do you think is holding you back within your stroke? Why the interest in the session, essentially? What do you think you can sort of gain from it?
I think when I pull through the left arm, it's weak.
Yes, yep.
And I compensate for that with the right arm.
Sure.
And I don't think, because of my unilateral breathing, I don't think I roll enough to the right-hand side.
Sure, okay, yes, yep.
I think the roll to the left is okay.
Interesting, yeah. How much should you be rotating? I'm interested.
I don't know,
okay.
I think I probably over-rotate on the left.
Sure, yeah. Okay, yeah.
I don't know. And I'm not sure if my kick is efficient. And I think I naturally have a slow stroke rate, and I think
okay.
It's probably too slow.
Too slow, yeah. Okay, sure, no problem. Why do you think you've got the slow stroke rate? Is there anything that you've been particularly working on within the stroke to try and actually improve it? Or
I don't know. I think when I've had coaching in the past, they've sort of said to start pulling down when I get to about there.
Okay, yes, yeah.
Maybe I do, maybe I wait too late.
Yeah, sure. Okay, no problem. Okay, good. All right, so let's have a little look at the stroke then and see what of that is true,
yep.
Okay, and what we can use to try and actually improve it. So all of what we're seeing right now has actually been recorded, including our voices over the top of it. So when you get home, you'll actually have a carbon copy of this to refer back to. So if we just look at let's start off by looking at the arm recovery actions, what you're doing over the top of the water. Yeah. Now, like I say, a lot of swimmers struggle with flexibility in their upper back and shoulders. This is on your good side, on the right-hand side here.
Yeah.
We see a very nice high elbow recovery. Okay, nice and relaxed in the shoulder. Even though the elbow's coming very high, you're actually still getting good clearance with that hand over the surface of the water there. Okay, so sometimes when swimmers swim with a very, very high elbow recovery, the hand almost looks like it's trailing through the water, or
yep.
Fingertips trail through the water. In fact, I took a guy for a session several years ago up at Challenge Stadium, and he was literally swimming almost like he was doing a finger trail drill.
Yeah.
I said, why are you doing that? He said, well, I was inside looking at the elites, and that's how they were all swimming. But had obviously seen them doing a finger trail drill
okay.
And just literally tried to copy it, basically.
Yeah. Okay.
So this recovery action over the top of the water looks nice. Okay, we've got a good bit of clearance here. And when we see the left arm coming out of the top of the water, we've still got really good range of movement here, okay, despite the fact that obviously we've got a little bit of an issue there on the left-hand side. So that's really nice to see. Now, we'll come back to this underwater shot in just a second. If we just look here from the surface. On this first 50 metres, you can see how your heels are breaking the surface of the water.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, that usually indicates that your body position is actually quite good. Okay. Now, this is actually going to change a little bit over the course of the 200 metres, and your legs quite rightly do drop down quite low in the water.
Oh, okay.
We need to ask the question why that's happening and how can we actually try and fix it.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, let's come to this angle here. All right. Now, going down the pool, you've pretty much hit the nail on the head there. You said that coaches have told you to start pulling through as that right arm's almost recovering over the top of the water there. And you said that you think you might be pulling through a bit late, actually pausing out in front of the stroke. Now, you're quite right in that. Way too much gliding.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. I don't know if you've seen our swim type system, have you?
Yeah.
So let me just sort of show you this. We've been able to identify six very specific types of swimmer based essentially on what's holding them back in the water. So just find my, where are we? Here we go. So we have an Arnie. Arnies typically have very low sinking legs in the water. They have a very quick stroke rate, too quick for the speed that they're actually swimming at. They literally look like they're churning their arms through the water and they're dragging their legs and very, very inefficient swimmers.
Yep.
We have a Bambino. Bambinos are very nervous in the water when they go to take a breath. Rather than you leading your arm out in front of your head too long, they don't leave it out there at all. It just sort of slides through or slices through the water. We have a Kicktastic. You thought your kick might need a little bit of tuning up. Kicktastics have a very strong dominant leg kick and sit very horizontally in the water.
Mm-hmm.
Don't necessarily have the greatest catch and pull through. But then we move on to this guy, the Overglider. Okay, now the biggest single thing holding an Overglider back in the water is the fact that when they reach forward, they actually stall out in front of their head. So the lead arm actually stays there too long, and in the process of leaving the arm out too long in front of the head, the body's actually stalling and simply slowing down. Because water's so dense, 800 times more dense than air, any sort of pause to the rhythm and momentum within the stroke, you're simply going to slow down. Okay. Now, I'm just going to show you exactly the implication of that within your particular stroke here, because when we see it from the top, if we weren't aware of that, okay, we might think, well, okay, well, the stroke's looking all right. It's looking very smooth, very controlled. If we actually time how many strokes you're doing per minute, so you think your stroke rate is a little bit on the low side. Let's actually measure that. Okay, so the stroke rate there, 36 strokes per minute.
Yep.
Now, let me show you why it's so slow. If we look at it underneath the water, we can see that when you're in this position here, the palm of the hand is actually coming up towards the surface of the water. So that's simply break. It's like a break.
It's slowing,
break
down.
Slowing you down massively, yeah. When you see it from the front, here, Phil, so just take a look at it from here, look. So the palm of the hand comes in, our fingertips come into the water, but then they reach up towards the surface, and unfortunately, that breaking surface there is simply slowing you down.
Yep.
It's a little bit more pronounced with the left-hand side there, look at that, okay, as we're coming into the water. So we need to actually try and remove that pause and delay with that lead hand, because it's simply slowing you down at this point in time. Now, when I talk to overgliders like yourself about trying to improve this, one misconception is that you might sort of think, well, hang on, I thought I should be trying to lengthen out the stroke, make it longer and smoother, basically, and slow things down to make it more efficient. I'm not going to be telling you today to actually turn your arms over faster. I'm actually going to show you how to actually remove this dead spot, and the net result will be that your arms will turn over faster.
Okay.
So actually remove the delay at the front end.
Yep.
Now, I'll just show you this guy here, because this is a guy that we use to often demonstrate this exact thing happening within the stroke. This guy called Scott. Scott came to me up at Challenge Stadium. It was probably about 2 or 3 years ago, this video clip. And he said, I don't know what's going wrong. I've been swimming for 5 years now, swimming 5 times per week, up to 3Ks per session. He said, I'm getting slower. I said, well, how fast are you swimming? And he said, no, about 25 minutes. And I assumed he meant 25 minutes for 1,500 meters. Okay, he actually means 25 minutes for a kilometer, so 2.5 minutes per 100.
Yep.
On the video clip that we just seen of you swimming there, you're swimming at about 150 per 100. So this guy is about 40 seconds, 100, slower than what you're swimming at. Now he's getting quite frustrated, and just before he sets off, he says, I don't know what's going wrong, because I can do 28 strokes per 50. And he says, that's better than Ian Thorpe. So yeah, Ian Thorpe used to swim about 31, 32.
Yeah.
So Scott's measure of efficiency is purely on how few strokes he can take down the pool.
Yeah.
Now, unfortunately, that's led to this stroke, which looks almost identical to yours in many respects. Now, again, he's got the nice high elbow recovery over the top of the water. Things look quite smooth. But if we pause it from this position up at the top, you'll actually see that the two hands, just like yourself, actually come together.
Yep.
It's almost like he's doing like the catch-up style of stroke.
Yeah.
Now, when we see that from underneath the water, his stroke rate is a lot slower than yours. His is down at 33 strokes per minute. But you can clearly see how he's just actually pausing in that position and simply slowing down.
Yeah.
So what we worked on with Scott was the same sort of thing. I said, look, we're not trying to make you swim, turn your arms over quicker. I'm going to show you how to actually remove that dead spot and get the momentum and rhythm of the stroke going a little bit better. The goal within his session was to try and get his stroke rate up to around about the 45 to 48 strokes per minute range,
mm-hmm.
which is quite a big jump, but it's still a lot slower than most swimmers would actually turn their arms over at.
Yeah.
By the end of the session, I actually got him up to 52 strokes per minute, okay, and he was actually swimming a lot better. In fact, he was actually swimming about 15 to 16 seconds per 50 faster than he was in the warm-up.
Yeah.
And you'd think he'd be impressed by that. You'd think he'd be happy about that improvement. He was disappointed because he was taking 4 more strokes to complete each 50 metres.
Okay.
So the reason I'm showing you that is obviously we just need to sort of get that sort of quite clear really in terms of actually why we're actually making these adjustments.
Yeah.
So ultimately, Phil, what determines how fast somebody moves through the water is a combination of how many strokes they're taking per length, but also how many strokes they're taking per minute.
Yep.
It's a little bit like when you're riding your bicycle and you look down at your cadence meter. It's no good being in the biggest possible gear that you can be in if you're only turning your legs over at 30 RPM.
Yep.
So we've got to get that rhythm working a little bit better for you. Now, if we sort of see that from the top again then, let's just come back to this position here and just slow it down. It's mainly when that left arm is out in front that we get that sort of pause. That right hand's not too bad. That left one is clearly the one that's actually applying the brakes there up at the front end of the stroke.
Yep.
Now, that all being said, your alignment is actually pretty good. We see this sort of, because this hand actually pauses in this position, the hand is actually pointing forwards, which is that it should be, but because it spends so long in this position, your legs are actually seeking balance. by scissor kicking apart.
Yep.
And obviously that creates significant drag.
Yep.
It's like opening up a parachute behind you. If we just watch our swimmer here, where have we got him? Swimmer that I'm going to show you now is a guy called Jono Van Hazel. Jono is the guy that we used to animate the Mr. Smooth animation from. Yep. I don't know if you've seen him on the website, basically. If we watch Jono swimming from the top, Jono's one of those swimmers who many people like to sort of try and emulate. Somebody like Scott had obviously tried to emulate Ian Thorpe, thinking that he had this really long stroke and a seemingly very slow stroke. Interesting enough, Ian Thorpe's stroke rate is 76 strokes per minute. Yours is 36,
yeah.
Scott's was 33. Ian Thorpe looks a lot slower than what it is, but the reality is that he's actually got a long stroke and a fast stroke. So when you're swimming 400 metres, 76 is very, very quick swimming.
Yep.
Now, Jono's a similar sort of stroke. So when we watch him here, look, he swims, in this video clip, he's swimming about 64 strokes per minute. But the difference between your stroke and his is that if we just pause it in this position, just draw a line through his head, many swimmers have grown up with the idea, like I just keep saying there, about the whole idea that we should try and make the stroke as long as we can. The idea of having this one hand forward in front of this yellow line at any one point in time is what people often refer to as front quadrant freestyle swimming. I don't know if you've come across that.
Yeah.
Now, watch what happens with your stroke. The two hands actually join each other there
in front of the head. Yeah.
So you could say, if somebody simply said, look, make sure that one hand is always forward in front of the head, you could say, well, I'm doing that right then. Watch Jono. He always has one hand forward in front of the head, but the two never actually meet.
Yeah.
So like the coaches have been saying to you, you need to pull through a little bit sooner. That's precisely right, basically.
Yep.
Okay, because that left arm, as you can see with Jono, is actually pressing back as that right hand's extending forwards.
Yep.
Okay. So seeing that, what we need to do then is we need to identify a couple of drills, which I'm going to take you through today to try and tune this up. Any change to your stroke is going to feel a bit strange. Okay. It feels strange to anybody making a change to their stroke.
Yeah.
One of the advantages of today's session is I'm actually going to set you up with a little headset, which is going to allow me to talk to you whilst you're swimming.
Okay.
And I'll be able to tell you, Phil, when you've actually got it right and when it still needs a bit of improvement, basically. So when you're making some of these changes, they might feel a bit strange initially, but if I'm telling you that's right now, that's what it should look like, try to tune into that sensation of how it feels, then we'll be able to make those adjustments. Now, arguably, the biggest drill that we're going to do today that's going to make a very positive impact on your swimming is this one here, sculling.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Have you ever done this before?
Yep.
Okay. Now, I'm doing this drill correctly right now with a pull buoy between my legs, so no kicking. The reason we're not kicking it, the reason we're using the pull buoy is that we're not actually getting any propulsion from the leg kick.
Yep.
I'm just purely moving forwards because my hands and arms are in the right position.
Yeah, okay.
And the right position there, Phil, is for the fingertips to be below the wrist and the wrist below the elbow. Many coaches talk about this idea of reaching over a barrel. I don't know if you ever heard that sort of thing. So when somebody's reaching forward, you want to be keeping your elbow nice and high and pressing the water back behind you.
Yep. Okay.
Now, it's the same sort of position that we see here. It's allowing me to move forwards. However, if I actually try and replicate what you're doing, so I'm moving forwards at the moment, now I'm trying to replicate what you're doing, where the elbow's sunk down and the fingertips are the highest point, you see that I'm actually pushing myself backwards.
Yep. Okay.
Now, why is this such a good drill for yourself to experience? Well, I'm going to get you to do it correctly and incorrectly. And if we just look at me doing it incorrectly, you can see obviously the palm of the hand presenting forwards.
Yep.
That's what we see within your stroke. When the palm of the hand presents forwards, the resistance of the water on the palm of the hand is actually greater than when you're doing it correctly. So a lot of people who do the overglide at the front end of the stroke feel resistance on the palm and think that's a catch.
Yeah.
But of course, it's actually slowing you down.
Yeah.
So when we make this change to the stroke today, Phil, get you catching the water and pulling through better, okay, it'll actually feel a bit strange because it'll almost feel like a lighter sensation in terms of how you pull through.
Okay.
All right. So sculling is going to be a very useful drill for you. Okay, now if we just take things a little bit further along, I asked that question, how much rotation do you think you need within the stroke? And you said, well, maybe I'm over rotating on one of the sides.
Yeah.
Okay, now we need a true head on shot to see this properly. So here we go. Now if we just pause that around about there. Back in the early 90s, there was a movement to suggest that everyone should be rotating on their sides, 90 degrees worth of rotation within their stroke. I don't know if you've ever come across that. Many people say
it's about 45 swim degrees.
Like, it should be about 45, yeah. So if we actually measure yours, though, we've got about 81 degrees worth of rotation there.
Yeah.
Now, this is on your, this is you on your right-hand side there. Yeah. Okay, if we look at it on the other side, whilst we go to take a breath, I'll just pause it and just draw on the same sort of thing here. Probably that position there. It's not quite so extreme there on that side. It wants to be between about 45 and 60 degrees.
Yeah.
Okay, so it's not quite so bad on that side there. Okay, but if we look at here, at, let's do a side-by-side comparison with double Olympic gold medalist Rebecca Adlington from the UK. She's got a fantastic stroke. Okay, now if we see her from the front, swimming towards the camera, we'll see that in this position, she's getting around about 45 to 50 degrees worth of rotation.
Yeah.
Now, she's got a beautiful smooth stroke. She'd, we'd actually classify her under our swim type system as a smooth.
Yeah.
And we can see there, about 53, 54 degrees worth of rotation there within the stroke.
Yeah.
So not over-rotating, not bringing herself onto 90 degrees on the side. And of course, the problem with over-rotating, as we saw from the surface looking down, just here, look, as it, we lose some balance within the stroke, and the way you compensate for that is by scissor kicking apart the legs. So I'm going to show you how to actually reduce a little bit of that rotation. It will actually happen purely by stopping you leaving that arm out as long as what you're doing out in front of the head, because it's like you're, you know, like I say, you're stalling in the water, trying to find balance, and that's why the legs are then scissor kicking apart. Now, if we see Rebecca from this side position, just to explain exactly what that catch should look like. Bring yourself out, it's perfect, look, okay. So, in this position here, you can see how different the two swimmers are. So, with yourself here, that palm of the hand is actually reaching up towards the surface of the water in an effort to sort of glide down the pool. Rebecca still stretches forward, look, she's still got a beautiful long reach in the water, but the fingertips are angled ever so slightly down. Now, watch what happens here. As she starts to pull through there, Phil, she just tips the fingertips down just a smidgen. Okay, probably just a little bit too much. I'll show you how to do this correctly when we get into the water. And then bends the elbow and presses back. But there's at no point within the stroke where that she's actually applying the brakes up at the front end there. Okay. Now, like I say, it's more pronounced with your left hand than with your right. That right one still needs a bit of correction. But look at the difference it makes to the actual stroke when you're actually doing it close to correct. So in this position here, if we look at the body position in the water, body's actually pretty horizontal there. Okay, I'm sure that's something you've worked on trying to actually improve over time, just trying to get reduce the amount of drag with the legs. But as soon as the left hand goes forwards, okay, the legs really start to sink very low in the water there.
Yeah.
See how low they've actually become?
Yeah.
And it's purely because this left arm is simply waiting out in front of your head too long.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, just thinking about our flexibility issue, if we draw this line on here, look, this is going to be quite an important specific point with yourself here. When somebody's in this position, if you were to think about this arc here basically is a roughly crudely drawn 180 degree arc basically that you can in theory pull yourself through to actually move yourself forwards. Most people would think, well, surely it makes most sense to actually start the catch as close to the surface as you possibly can. Okay. However, if there's some restriction in the rotation, in the flexibility and mobility in the shoulder there, the elbow is always going to end up sinking low, and the palm of the hand is going to be facing forward as you're doing here.
Yep.
So one of the easiest ways to correct this with yourself is to get you doing some exercises where we think about keeping the elbow in a similar position, but actually having the hand reach into a slightly deeper position. Now you might think, I'm wasting all of that catch, but remember that's not
it's
a catch
efficient.
At the moment, it's not efficient, it's slowing you down, exactly right. So one of the drills, the first drill I'm going to start you off with today is a drill which we do all the time within the squad. It's simply kicking on the side like we can see here.
Yep.
Now if we see this from underneath the water, oops, here we go, that's the position there. when I'm talking to you today with the little headset on, we'll be trying to actually emulate that same position. Your natural default will be, as we've seen on the video, for the hand to want to reach up, especially when you tilt your head to the side to try and take a breath in. To help you overcome that, I'm going to give you a pair of paddles with that lead hand on, so that every time you do that, you'll actually feel yourself slowing down. You'll feel your legs sinking as a consequence. So this will actually teach you to keep the fingertips a little bit lower. Okay. All right. Now, just before we summarize all of this, Phil, and jump back into the water and start to work on it, there's one final thing I just want to point out, and it's arguably, you could say, the most important thing. Can you tell me what is missing in that frame?
I'm not breathing out.
Perfect. Very good. Okay. Now, we often see, well, we see this in awesome types, basically, but we especially see it in overgliders when they actually look like they're really thinking about what's going on. So the stroke becomes a little bit sort of methodical, tend to hold on to the breath whilst you're actually concentrating.
Yeah.
And there's going to be times in today's session when I ask you to be trying to fix a certain aspect of the stroke where you'll resort back to actually holding on to your breath just whilst you're concentrating. So I'll remind you about that.
Yeah.
And the problem with holding on to the breath, of course, is it gives you buoyancy here and sinks your legs down at the back. Now, over in the UK, where we're both from, they actually teach swimmers through the system over there to actually hold your breath, to actually improve your buoyancy.
Yeah.
But if you think about it, the only place it's going to improve the buoyancy is here, and it's going to ultimately cause the legs to sink lower at the back.
Yeah.
Now, for yourself as well, doing things like the anaconda, the last thing we want to be doing is making the stroke any more anaerobic than what it really should be.
Yeah.
You'd never go for a run or ride your bike and actually hold onto your breath. You'd either be breathing in or breathing out.
Yeah.
So the very first thing we're going to do today, I'm going to spend 2 minutes with you down at the far end of the pool, showing you how to actually improve your exhalation.
Yeah.
It'll almost be, it should actually just feel like a light bulb's gone on, basically, when I've actually just shown you how to do it. There's a little exercise we're going to do down at the far end of the pool. I'm going to get you to try and sink down to the bottom of the pool. The only possible way you'll be able to do that is if you let the air go.
Yeah.
We'll then try and transfer that same sensation across into freestyle. It should just feel like you're a little bit more aerobic and help to keep the bum and legs up a little bit higher.
Yeah.
Once we've then done that, I'll give you a pair of these flippers. We'll do the side kicking thing, just trying to get the position of the arm a little bit better. And then we'll actually finish off with doing some work in the actual catch to make sure that the palm of the hands aren't presenting themselves forward and actually slowing you down.
Yeah.
The net result of all of that in today's session will be that the stroke rate will come up from 36.5 strokes per minute, I'm hoping, to the low 50s. I don't think this is going to be a major, major change. It's going to feel very different.
Yeah.
But I don't think it's going to be a major, major change or a big obstacle for you to actually try and change there, Phil. Okay, so we'll see what we can do with that. Now, like I say, all of this has actually been recorded for you. So when you get home, you'll actually have a carbon copy of this to refer back to. Just watch here, look. See how that hand reaches up towards the surface and look at how low the legs become.
Yep.
So again, just emphasizing that right here, all you're really doing is sinking legs because you're actually pushing down with that lead arm there. Now, this has all been recorded for you. I'm going to give you a copy of the Overglider guide to take away with you as well.
Yep.
The Overglider guide contains all the drills and in the order in which you need to do them, just to give you a nice systemized approach to what we're going to do today. I don't recommend, look, that's not you, but it might as well be.
Yeah.
See the palm of the hand presenting forward there. Now, I don't expect you to remember all of these drills, but this will actually help you to tune it up. When you get home, I wouldn't recommend changing all of these sessions just to the sessions that are in the Overglider guide. I recommend maybe doing one of these sessions per week where you just solely focus on tuning up the rest of the stroke itself.
Yeah.
I think especially with your focus on, you know, the anaconda, etc., we need to ensure that we're actually still getting in some good sort of fitness specific sets and building some endurance, etc., etc.
Yep.
It's very easy when you're sort of presented with, okay, a couple of aspects of your stroke that you want to try and tune up on. It's very easy to become what we call a technique hermit, whereby you go away and you just do drill after drill after drill after drill. Unfortunately, that's what Scott had done.
Yeah.
So Scott tried to make his stroke longer. He'd been doing drills to make his stroke longer, but inadvertently actually slowed down over the course of that.
Yep.
So just do one of these sessions per week and still keep your sort of fitness, swim specific fitness sets going there as well.
Yep.
Okay, I'm going to stick that onto a DVD for you and you'll have that to take home with you today. Now, any major surprises then with what you saw on the video? I think you pretty much described it exactly as it was. It's, I must admit, I had a guy for a session earlier on this week, and I hadn't seen him for 2 years actually. Just quickly show you this, because This is why I'm quite confident that you're going to be able to make these changes quite quickly within the stroke. This guy, for the last 2 years, he very kindly let us use his video clip, because the video clip is, what is your perception of your stroke like? I don't know if you follow our blog, but this is actually going out on our blog this evening about this guy's development. So, like I asked you, what do you think is holding you back? I asked this guy the same thing, and he said, I think my legs are dragging. That's what he perceived to be the biggest single thing holding him back. And I said, how low do you think they are? And he says, about 4 or 5 centimetres.
Yeah.
But when you see it in reality, much lower than that. Probably about 60 centimetres low in the water. So, whilst he was on the right track, his perception was way off. Your perception is actually very close to reality of what we're actually seeing on the video clip. And that's a good thing.
It's always hard because you can't see yourself. Yeah,
that's right. Until you have the video done, basically. Exactly right. But with the combination of seeing the video and being able to talk to you in real time whilst you're swimming along, we should be able to make some good leaps forward with that today. Okay, so that's all on there. So we've got your raw video footage on here. We've got your swim type guide, the Overglider guide. Do you use a Mac or a PC?
Mac.
Mac, okay, cool. In this little folder here, the Mac will actually run the QuickTime video file I've actually just created here for you, no problem. So you won't have any issues with that. Okay, let's just stop this recording then.